Dear Bethesda, hi, it's me, Austin. Look, we've been through this before, so let's just skip the foreplay. You know why I'm here. In fact, you may have seen this coming for a while. I know I have. It comes up in the comments of almost every single letter I write to you. You know what I'm talking about. Fusion cores. Actually, you've never responded to a single letter I've written to you other than blah, 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 ex parte this, legal counsel representing Mr. Howard that, so maybe you weren't dreading it at all. I know that I have, however. Fusion technology is a fucking beast to talk about and work the math on, and I thought it would be an impossible topic to cover, and yet, here we are. So, let's get down to it and talk about the most advanced and surprisingly badass piece of tech in the entire Fallout franchise. Your fusion cores come up frequently because, well, some people don't like them. People like Runemaker and Gamecrow are expecting me to rip your fusion cores to shreds in a rant so spectacular that it ripples through the space-time continuum to the design board 7 years ago and convinces you not to put fusion cores in the game at all. And to understand why this is, first we're gonna have to talk about the lore of fusion technology in Fallout and the science behind real nuclear fusion and a whole host of other things that are so fucking cool they have to be measured in Kelvin. Anybody? Anyone? Alright. Fusion technology has been at the heart of the Fallout franchise since its inception, with microfusion being the darling of the series. Microfusion cells were the answer to the huge energy demands of weapons like laser rifles, plasma rifles, and even the giant Gatling lasers. Microfusion cells are described as self-contained fusion reactors and are analogous to batteries, and for the most part, this has remained consistent across the various titles, all the way up to and including Fallout 4. But what is a fusion reactor? Well, it's a place where fusion reaction happens. Okay, that's not helpful. But it's true! More specifically though, in terms of energy and power, a fusion reactor is a method for creating harnessable electricity from controlled fusion reactions. In order to understand this fictional technology a bit better though, let's look at something that's very, very real in our world, nuclear power plants. Nuclear power plants create energy the same way we've been creating energy for generations, boiling water. No, seriously, a modern day nuclear reactor basically works by engineers chucking a hunk of enriched uranium in a bucket of water so it heats the water up. Eventually, the water boils into steam. This steam pushes turbines, which in turn transform kinetic energy into electricity. Nuclear power plants take advantage of the energy released by nuclear fission, which is the polar opposite of nuclear fusion. Nuclear fission is honestly pretty complicated, and there's many, many types, but at a basic level, it's just an atom falling apart. When these atomic particles separate, energy is released, and in the case of uranium-235, this energy is consistent, predictable, and harnessable for the slow creation of electricity in a nuclear power plant, or can be weaponized and forced to undergo fission rapidly, releasing nearly all of its energy all at once, and we know how that story ends. Fusion, by contrast, isn't atoms breaking apart because they can't hold themselves together, but actually two atoms smashing into one another to form a new, heavier atom. And while we haven't quite figured out how to induce controlled fusion for the purposes of creating power, we've still managed to make it happen anyway. We haven't found a way to make fusion so that it produces more energy than it takes to create and sustain it, although in the 1970s, the Pacer Project briefly considered detonating hydrogen bombs underground and using their energy to heat water. Do not mix cocaine with engineering! The biggest hurdles with nuclear fusion are the immense amounts of energy that are needed to create the conditions that make fusion possible, containing the materials, and finding a way to extract the energy itself. If it's such a pain in the ass, why are scientists throwing themselves at the problem every day trying to find out a way to make it work? Well, because the energy released by nuclear fusion is incredibly high, and the materials used in it are incredibly abundant and clean. The easiest atoms to fuse are hydrogen atoms, and hydrogen is fucking everywhere. It's just littering our planet. Turn on the faucet and it's there. Uranium, by contrast, can be kind of a bitch to find, and making enriched uranium is even more of a bitch, and it leaves behind tons of radioactive garbage once it's been depleted. After hydrogen's been completely fused, all that's left is some non-radioactive helium, hydrogen, and a few dangerous neutrons, but nothing compared to uranium, and nothing that couldn't be disposed of easily. In order for fusion to happen, materials have to be heated up until they become plasma, and then they have to be heated up even more so that the atoms are moving fast as fuck and are more likely to slam into one another. How hot is hot? Well, it depends upon what you're trying to fuse, but it ranges from 100 million Kelvin. Kevin. No. But it ranges from 100 million Kelvin, 4 times hotter than the core of the fucking sun, to over 1 billion Kelvin, the temperature the universe was for several seconds during and after the Big Bang. Stars can create fusion at lower temperatures because they make up with their relative chilliness with incredible pressures we could never hope to replicate on our planet. Keeping something that's 100 million Kelvin in a bottle is no easy feat, but we're not here to look at that. At all. If I had the answers on how to reliably produce nuclear fusion for the purposes of meaningful energy, I wouldn't be making YouTube videos right now. I'd be sipping margaritas at my personal villa carved into the side of Cerro de la Silla Mountain overlooking Monterrey. The point is, at some point in the history of the Fallout world, pre-war scientists and engineers not only solved the problem of creating centralized fusion power plants, but also found a way to reduce this technology into distributable, high-energy density consumer and military power units in the form of microfusion cells and fusion cores. Fast forward to Fallout 4, and we're ejecting and slapping fusion cores into suits of power armor and Gatling lasers at a somewhat alarming rate, something that comes as a bit of a surprise to those of us who have played other games in the franchise and are used to wantonly running around in power armor without any consequences. More alarming even is that fusion cores seem to be operating without problems for hundreds of years and then dissipate in what feels like minutes once inserted into a suit of power armor. What's actually going on here? Well, in order to figure that out, we're gonna have to do some science! What's in a fusion core? Hydrogen. Probably. Why hydrogen? Well, it's abundant, sure, but it's also the easiest element to fuse and contain. Fusion can be initiated at comparatively low temperatures of 100 million Kelvin. Scientists in our real world are particularly interested in two specific isotopes of hydrogen, deuterium and tritium. Normal hydrogen is pretty simple. It's about as simple as you can get, actually. It's just one proton surrounded by one electron. Deuterium, however, has an extra neutron tacked onto it, and tritium has two neutrons. And when these two atoms collide, they form helium-4 and release an assload of energy. Well, okay, actually, it's almost no energy at all per fusion, a paltry 17.59 mega electron volts, which is such a small amount of energy, I can't give you something to compare to. It's practically nothing, but you take a shit ton of these atoms, which are pretty damn light, and fuse them together, that energy starts to add up quickly. And all you need is some pure deuterium gas, since deuterium can fuse with itself to create tritium. Of course, having all these atoms together doesn't mean they're gonna fuse exactly how you want them to, and deuterium goes through something called a cycle, which is all the possible fusions it can make, which thankfully is pretty small. You can take all these possible reactions and add their power output together, which will give you a pretty accurate average of how much energy you'll get per 6 deuterium atoms you have in your gas, which is 43.2 mega electron volts. So it's pretty safe to say that the gas being used in fusion cores is deuterium, but how much is there? Well, in order to figure that out, we have to figure out how much energy is in a fusion core. Impossible, you say? Ha 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 ha! Sit your ass down, strap yourself in, and get ready for shit to get awesome! Of course, fusion generators were added into Fallout 4's Wasteland Workshop add-on, and I could have probably built one and connected a bunch of light bulbs into it in order to estimate its power, but that would have required me to learn the settlement system, so fuck that shit. You see, fusion cores power power armor, sure, but they also power the heavy Gatling laser weapon. Our Gatling laser is the key to our fusion core's energy potential, but we need something to compare to. Gatling lasers are, effectively, the science fiction answer to miniguns, an actual weapon we have in our real world. So, I opened up one of my survival games where weapon damage is more realistic and spawned and murdered a bunch of raiders at point blank range, recorded how many shots it took to kill them, did the same thing with the Gatling laser, and averaged all my answers. I killed 50 raider veterans with each weapon, and the Gatling laser is actually quite a bit stronger than the minigun. 1.785 times, in fact. Real world miniguns fire 7.62 by 51mm NATO rounds and deliver a terrifying 3,304 joules of energy per round. Miniguns in the Fallout world, however, fire 5mm rounds, which thankfully are much less intense and are gonna make our numbers manageable. The rare 5mm Remington ammunition delivers 504 joules at a fraction of a second. So, if we take this and multiply it by our handy 1.785, we get a whopping 899 joules per shot for our Gatling laser. Delivered over the same amount of time, this means that the Gatling laser is delivering 2.06 megawatts. This means in less time than you can blink, this laser is delivering the same amount of power of an LMS class locomotive train engine. Maximizing power efficiency with all the nuclear physicist perks, a fusion core has an average of 624 shots per core, bringing our total wattage at 1.28 gigawatts over a quarter of a second. The power output of a fucking hydroelectric dam. Now, I know that sounds intense and impossible, but it's a surprisingly achievable level of energy. Even today, the wattage is a bit extreme, but that's the amount of energy in a lithium ion battery weighing a surprisingly light pound and a half. Less than a kilogram. So, in order to... what's that? Oh shit, I'm running out of time? Fuck. Have you seen my spreadsheet? I have so much more to go. Okay, let me, just one sec, just cue the music. No, not that music, fuck you. You know what music I'm talking about. Yes, that music, thank you. Jesus. Knowing how much energy and power is in our Gatling laser, we can work our way backwards and figure out how much energy is in our fusion cores. Lasers are a notoriously lossy means of energy delivery, which is why energy weapons have been taken off in our world, and on a good day usually waste over 60% of their energy into the heat of the source generating them. We'll see they made lasers more efficient in the world of Fallout and waste only 40% of their energy. In order to find out how much energy is used, we multiply energy delivered by 1.4, and to change that from joules to megaelectron volts, we multiply by Avogadro's constant to get a number in the quintillions. Divide that by the number of megaelectron volts created per deuterium cycle to get how many fusion cycles it would take to create that amount of energy. Multiply that number by 6, the number of atoms used per cycle, to determine how many deuterium atoms in total it would take to create that much energy. Divide that number by 2 to get how many molecules of D2, aka 2H2 gas that is. Since D2 gas is 2 deuterium molecules bound together. Divide by Avogadro's constant, yes I know this process could probably be simplified, to get how many moles of gas that is, which you can use to determine how much mass that gas will take up. Almost none. Great. Fractions of a gram and fractions of a pound. Cool. Of course this isn't the only factor to consider, and presuming that fusion is created on demand to meet energy demands, this means that gas is going to be needed to be kept at a state of near fusion, which requires energy to maintain. Since most of the readily available form of energy is in the cell itself, it stands to reason that fusion is used to sustain the heat and run the process. This means that over time there will be a power draw and loss of fusible atoms. Since all power cores were created at least 210 years before Fallout 4, we can presume that they have enough deuterium gas in them to maintain fusion for 210 years, plus the gas that's used by the core itself in the game. To determine this draw, I took a percentage of one cycle's worth of atoms consumed to create energy from one shot from the Gatling laser, took that in atoms per second consumed, and atoms per year, and atoms for 210 years. I added this on top of other gas, giving us the amount of hydrogen atoms that were consumed in total from the time the bombs were dropped in 2077 all the way up until they're fully discharged in 2287 in Fallout 4. I then hopped in a suit of powder armor and depleted three cores, one by just running around at normal speed, and one while sprinting nonstop, and a third by jetpack. This gave me time in real-world seconds it took to deplete the core with various activities. Knowing the total energy in the core, and knowing that one real-world second is actually 20 seconds of Fallout 4, I was able to determine power draw in watts power armor actually has. 9.63 watts for just running around, 109.17 watts for sprinting, and a feisty 1,106.42 watts for the jetpack. Applying hydrogen degradation time plus an average use per day model with three wattage buckets, I was actually able to paint a picture for usage time for all four Fallout games prior to Fallout 4, with a single core lasting 63 years in Fallout 1, 23 years in Fallout 2, 5 years in Fallout 3, and 3 years in Fallout New Vegas. Somewhat troubling, however, is that this means that the fusion cores are scheduled to all be completely expired 62 days after the start of Fallout 4, whether they've been used or not due to the amount of hydrogen that's depleted to maintain the plasma state. The life of the cores can be extended with the inclusion of a lithium-ion chemical battery, which has the energy density of 0.876 megajoules per kilogram, but this eventually would bleed away as well, leaving the world without fusion cores, and incidentally, the Brotherhood of Steel completely impotent in the face of the Institute, unless they can find a way to refuel them. Interestingly, I applied the same numbers to brand new cores manufactured in 2077 and discovered that with average to heavy use of 12 hours a day, a brand new fully charged core would last 105 fucking years, which is exactly the amount of time writers in Fallout 1 said the fuel and power armor would last. The biggest danger is failure of components. Likely, safeguards were put in place, but should any of them fail, any number of extraordinarily fucking terrible things could happen. Best case scenario, the core simply goes cold, but if containment fails, then the core would turn into a rocket projectile shooting face-melting hot plasma all over anybody unfortunate enough to be close. And if fusion regulators fail and let fusion go unchecked, it could release all the remaining energy at once, resulting at best blowing up the person using it and anyone nearby, and at worst, turning the surrounding city block into a crater of molten rubble and powderized flesh! Anyway, turns out your fusion cores are actually pretty legit, Bethesda. I'm surprised. I'm also entirely certain you didn't put this much thought into it. In either case, I really think people need to consider not complaining about a piece of technology that still manages to work after being abandoned for 2 centuries. Apple could really take a page out of your book. Sincerely, Austin. P.S. Do you know that I used to do web design work? I hated it. I mean, there's not just the problem of getting one thing wrong with CSS or HTML and having to spend 2 hours finding the broken bracket, but there's also cross-site optimization and clients who, for some fucking reason, were still using Internet Explorer 6 in 2014. What is the matter with you? Anyway, when I got married, I actually made a website for it, but I didn't want to deal with the headache for something that was supposed to be so much fun. So I made our site with Squarespace, which is why I was totally pumped when they approached us to sponsor this episode. Squarespace makes it incredibly easy to make a website with intuitive and killer-looking modern templates, and can be used for anything from a blog to an online store. They even have tools that let you easily set up an online store. And when you sign up, you get a free domain name. If you want to start a free trial, head on over to squarespace.com and enter the offer code SHODDY to get 10% off your first purchase. Oh, also, head on over to our Twitch channel, twitch.tv/shoddycast. Starting at 10 a.m., I'm going to be finishing up my playthrough of Mirror's Edge Catalyst, and then later in the week, I'll be creating a poll for you guys for what you guys want to see next. Thank you, everyone, for watching my video about Fusion Cores! I put so much work into this. If you want to check out my spreadsheet that I built, I don't think I covered everything in it. I have a link in the description that you can see all my math and you can see the different parameters. If you copy it into your own Google Doc, you can actually change some of the numbers. Everything will automatically update. This was actually really fun. My favorite part of making this episode was when I was plugging in the numbers and made usage percentages and came in at a brand new core lasting over 100 years. And I was like, whoa, like I did not intentionally do that, but it happened like that with the numbers that I ran, that fusion cores as they are in Fallout 4 actually are lore consistent with Interplay's lore in the beginning of Fallout 1 and 2. That is so cool. I was totally stoked about that. I know that no one did, you know, mass, you know, fusion microelectron volt math in Bethesda, but I'm still pretty stoked about that. I want to throw out a personal thank you to our Patreon supporters who make this show possible. You guys are fucking awesome. We have sponsorships and that certainly helps, but Patreon is the engine that drives our channel. So you guys rock. And if you want to become a patron and you're not, you can head over to our Patreon page right now and contribute whatever you want. If you contribute $3 a month, you get early access to most videos. Sometimes these ones, but I'm not getting them out super late. If you haven't subscribed to our channel yet, do it down there. Just boom, hit it, because I do these all the time and they're fun. They're exhausting. I'm sweating right now. Is that it? You can follow me on Twitter at @arhorrigan and follow Shoddycast at @shoddycast, and that is it. Yeah, bye. Okay, I'm going. Bye. See you.